begins with our need for salvation. Listen to the prophecy of Isaiah. Oh, that you would tear open the heavens and come down, so that the mountains would quake at your presence. As when fire kindles brushwood and the fire causes water to boil, to make your name known to your adversaries, so that the nations might tremble at your presence.
Today we begin the candlelighting with our prayer, Save Us. In the next 3 weeks, we will pray for God to know us, and to love us, and to be with us. We are sometimes desperate when we pray for God to save us, desperate with deep emotions, our own sins, rage, and the question, is there anyone there? Then God answers, I am everywhere.
Let us pray. Jesus, we pray that you would come into our world and save us from our sin and from the hurts that we experience here on earth. We pray that we would know you as our Savior, even as a baby in the manger. Come, Jesus, and save us. Amen.
Let us read responsively, the call to worship. Responsibly, too. Hear me, the faithful find salvation, and the careless be awakened.
Here may the doubting find faith, and the anxious be encouraged.
Here may the tempted find help, and the sorrowful comfort.
Here may the weary find rest, and the strong be renewed.
Here may the aged find consolation, and the young be inspired.
May our advent return to share God's light to a world in darkness.
Come, let us worship with anticipation. Charitable.
You actually become more charitable by noticing when you are not being charitable and sweeping or weeping over it. But none of us want to see our own faults. They usually have to be shoved in our face, or we have to fall right into them. At least I do. And even then, many will just deny their mistakes more forcibly. Peter's three denials come to mind here. Let us pray together the prayer of confession.
Lord, I've too often denied that I even knew you. When times get tough, I have pretended that I was not your disciple. Forgive me the many times I have missed opportunities to share with others how I live by your grace. Hear my silent prayers.
Amen. When we surrender ourselves to healing, we have to have three spaces opened up within us, all at the same time. Our opinionated head, our closed down heart, and our defensive and defended body. That is the core work of all spirituality, and it is work. Yet it is finally the work of a power greater than ourselves. By the power of the risen Christ
and the love of God, we are forgiven.
Since God has forgiven us in Christ, and let us forgive one another, the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Each week another candle will be lit, Imagine if we were in a church many, many years ago that didn't have any lights. How did they light up the churches on dark days without electricity? With candles. So every week, one more candle will be lit and things will get just a little bit brighter. And your job is to share that brightness with others by doing nice things and showing how much you love people and even saying happy birthday to Ari tomorrow. Let us pray. Here.
To the house of Israel and the house of Judah, in those days and at that auspicious branch to spring up for David, and he shall execute justice and righteousness in the land. In those days, Judah will be saved, and Jerusalem will live in safety. And this is the name by which it will be called: the Lord is our righteousness. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And the unison psalm reading is Psalm 25, 1 through 10. Let us read together. To you, O Lord, I lift up my soul. O my God, you renew my trust. Do not let me be put to shame. Do not let my enemies exult over me. Do not let those who wait for you to be put to shame. Let them be ashamed who are wont only of treacherous.
Make me know your ways, O Lord. Teach me your paths. Lead me in your truth and teach me. For you are the God of my salvation. For you I wait all day long. Be mindful of your mercy, O Lord, and of your steadfast love. For they have been from of old.
Do not remember the sins of my youth, or my transgressions.
According to your steadfast love, remember me, for your goodness' sake, O Lord. Good and upright is the Lord, therefore he instructs sinners in the way. He leads the humble in what is right, and teaches the humble his way. All the paths of the Lord are steadfast love and faithfulness for those who keep his covenant and his decrees.
The word of the Lord.
Praise be to God.
Signs of the sun, the moon, and the stars, and on the earth, distress among nations, confused by the roaring of the sea and waves. People will faint from fear and foreboding of what is coming upon the world, for the powers of the heavens will be shaken. Then they will see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. Now when these things begin to take place, stand up, raise up your heads, because your redemption is drawing near. And then he told them a parable. Look at the fig tree and all the trees. As soon as they sprout leaves, you can see for yourselves and know that summer is already near. So also, when you see these devastating things taking place, you know that the kingdom of God is near. Truly, I tell you, this generation will not pass away until all things have taken place. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away. Be on guard so that your hearts are not weighed down with dissipation and drunkenness and the worries of this life, and that day catch you unexpectedly like a trap. For it will come upon all who live on the face of the whole earth. Be alert at all times, praying that you may have the strength to escape all these things that will take place and to stand before the Son of Man. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Christ.
Let us pray. O God, in addition to the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart, give me the will and the capacity to put into action the meaning of Advent through Christ, who gives me the power to forgive and be forgiven, and to be faithful and fruitful. In Jesus' name. Amen. Science has actually found evidence of the light of the first day of creation. Scientists may call it the Big Bang Theory, but all of creation began with God. Now, how do we know about this residual light? Scientists, if they look into outer space with the light,
or darkness. But it is not dead. Radio telescopes show that it is actually neutrinos, which are part of light. There is light in the darkness. Or as the Gospel of John says, in the beginning was light, and the light was for all people, and the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. John goes on to say that true light, which enlightens everyone, was coming into the world. And the first words that God ever spoke, "Let there be light." And then the first comment about God, "And God saw that the light was good." So we begin Advent with light, the lighting of an Advent candle, the light in a dark world. Another image of Advent is the second coming of Jesus. The baby in the manger is an easy image for us to see in our minds, but the second coming is much harder. Jesus talks about the Son of Man coming in a cloud. It's a reference to an image in the book of Daniel, an apocalyptic book. Rather hard for us to imagine. But remember, the ultimate end of all things is not a terrorist or mass shooting or the greed of financial markets or the loss of 225 jobs at West Rock or the car chase and capture of a man soliciting a young girl or even the pride of our own egos. The end of all things is the Son of Man. And the end of all things with the Son of Man is the mercy and love of God. That is God's promise. Now is the time to see when the rays, where and when the rays of light are coming through the darkness. In our Changing Lives Together, a booklet that you will be receiving in the mail, there are 40 pictures showing all the different work of the church, the different boards, the different committees. Look through it when it arrives, because Changing Lives Together, the name of this booklet, shows the many ways in which we work together, empowered by God, to change lives one at a time. In a world where the news is always desperate, in a world where the news does not ever seem to be good, this little booklet has good news for us and for all of God's people. Because God keeps God's promises, and we are on that adventure together, an adventure of adventing in time, a new arrival, a new beginning, a new day is dawning. These words that we heard read from the prophet Jeremiah were good news at a time of bad news. The community in Jerusalem had been completely devastated, taken over by the Babylonians, the people of Israel sent into exile. And out of captivity in the 7th century B.C., the inhabitants were scattered far and wide. The sense of their security had been violated. Where is God, they asked, in the midst of all of this? Why did such devastation happen? Where is the evidence that God even cares about us anymore? Yet Jeremiah insists that the future is certain. It is held in God's hands, and God will fulfill God's promises. That confidence in God's righteousness enables belief into a new reality. Advent invites us to see in the spaces where the world only sees darkness, but the love of God sees tiny particles of light. That is the vision of justice and righteousness. We move forward in ways that we do not even understand, and through the quiet workings of time and grace, as deep calls to deep in the words of the psalmist in Psalm 42. The unmanageable parts of our lives cry out to us from the depths, just out of sight and almost out of the limits of our hearing. So it takes a special effort to pay attention to where we are messing up our own lives. As we heard in the call to the prayer of confession, we'd rather push aside those parts of ourselves we would rather not face. And just out of our own survival of body, mind, and spirit, we push it aside and cannot even hear it sometimes from the words of our friends. The unmanageable parts of our lives call out for a God to heal them. And so our first Advent candle is save us. Save us, God, from ourselves first. Both Jesus and Paul were hated by their own groups precisely because they were constantly talking about change, how each of us need to change. And the first thing Jesus said when he started preaching was, "Repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand." Repent is to turn, to change directions. It is to change around your own mind. And most of us would rather not move toward any new way of thinking or change any part of our own opinions or our own mind until we're forced to, which usually means God needs to send us through some time of suffering in order to give us that new enlightenment. Some disturbance that's going to upset our habits, the way in which we usually walk and think and act and speak. So as each candle gives us a little more light in Advent, God wants to show us a little more of ourselves and to show us more people who need our light, our love. So as God has us look inwardly more and we see more of who we really are, God then enables us to love other people we had not seen. People are unpredictable. And because people are unpredictable, we each want to stay in control of a situation. And if we want to stay in control, then we should never change the way in which we think. Because then you don't have to change your way of relating to people. People are predictable if we think they'll do the same thing over and over. We're predictable if we just do what everyone expects us to think. And that is not God's ways. It's what Cardinal Newman said. To live is to change, and to be perfect is to have changed often. Advent is a time God is inviting us to change. Change our habits, change the way in which we think about ourselves, and the way in which we think about others. Now, Jeremiah had been put under house arrest by the king. And the reason he was put under house arrest was there was too much doom and gloom in all of his messages. That's why you don't hear too much hellfire and damnation from the pulpit. I'd rather not be put under house arrest. Now, ironically, at the very moment that Jeremiah gets put under house arrest, he comes out with this incredible statement about hope. When he goes through times of suffering, God showed him the way had to be one of hope, not of despair. So we can identify with Jeremiah shut up in that courtyard, away from the people, away from his friends, but left only with his faith. We too can feel trapped, locked up inside a spiral of events that have devastated our ability to feel secure, or to have any sense that the future might be in God's hands. We're living in a world right now with a lot of sharp edges that keep catching us and causing us pain. Now, both Mary and John the Baptist at the beginning of Luke, and Jesus here himself in Luke 21 near the end of the Gospel, were not wrong. The kingdom of God is going to make all the difference in this world. It will be God's grand reversal of fortunes, God's glorious return of this creation to what he intended in the beginning. It may not come immediately. It will be in a while. And so we sing with the choir, "Come, thou long expected Jesus." Or as we would put it, "Where the heck have you been?" We're living under a lot of shadows. The shadow of ISIS and mayhem in several places in the world. And the lone candle of Advent seems pretty weak. Again, without all the electric lights on a dark, dismal day in a dark, dismal world, one little candle shines. And so we need more hope, more candles, more people glowing with God's love, more people willing to change their minds. 3 years ago, people on the East Coast celebrated Christmas in the midst of Superstorm Sandy's recent devastation. That year, President Obama, in one of his talks, mentioned a man he had met whose house had been smashed by a 30-foot pine tree. Finally, the crews arrived to remove the tree from his house to begin the repair of the home when all of the neighborhood had been smashed homes also. But as the crews took away the tree, he stopped them. And he cut the 7 foot off the top and took that Christmas tree, put it in his front yard. There wasn't much to decorate it with. Most of the ornaments had been smashed along with his house, but he found a few things. And then he also found a few things that had been left over from the storm itself. He found surgical masks and battered coffee cups and just things that had been cast aside. The signs of the devastation were then put on this Christmas tree of hope. The tree was a sign of resilience, a sign of hope, and a desire to rebuild. And people would walk by his house and add other things to that tree. In a sense, that tree was an Advent candle of hope. So as we begin Advent again in our devastated world, God carves out a piece and real estate in the form of his only Son, our Lord, the body of Christ. It stood then, and it stands for us in heaven now as a sign of hope, of resilience, of a divine intention to take this sin-battered world and rebuild it. The days are coming. Jesus is not finished yet. As we will sing in a moment, Jesus promised justice in the land to those who were enslaved. You said that one day by your hand, your cities would be saved. Save us, O Lord, and we light the first candle. Amen.
Custodian.
Barb Wheeler is now recovering at home. She was at Jay's, her son Jay's home for a while. And we're glad Velma Hoffman is back with us. And the Bible study group had met there last Sunday in order to be with her. We also give thanks for Wilma Hunt's mother, Ida Springs' 98th birthday. And our prayers are with Matt Downing following the death of his fraternal grandmother who passed away in Uhrigsville. Our prayers also with the victims and families of victims of the Colorado Springs shooting. And with Muskingum Valley Presbyterian, our prayers with the McConnellsville First Presbyterian Church, and with pastors Mark Barron and Sue Dixon in our presbytery. I invite your prayers of intercession and petition your prayers of thanksgiving and praise.
Our friend Zach with diagnostic tests.
Okay, friend Zach with diagnostic tests. Yes. Close friend of Kayla's at school having tests and not sure what's going on. Yes, Colin.
Craig, for me, and I put over in Paris while the climate talks are going on over in the UN.
Peace in Paris as the climate talks are going on with the United Nations. Let us pray. Loving God, we thank you for Thanksgiving meals of old, for the times we grew up, for the times with family, even for the strange things that happen sometimes, the outbursts of anger when we were impatient and tired, the outbursts of joy when we were living it up and lighthearted. So we thank you that our Thanksgiving meals are really simply a reflection of our families. Join us together that every Sunday and every day would be a Thanksgiving day, and that as we gather around the food, sometimes with food prepared, sometimes with the delights of the harvest season, sometimes simply waiting for each of us to come, we are grateful that you call all people to your table. None are excluded. There is no fence around it. It is not just for saints, but for all sinners. Not just for the holy, but those who are going through life, crying out, save us, save us. Keep the words of the Psalms on our lips, that we would pray for your guidance in all aspects of our lives, even as we give you thanks for those hearts and lives changed one at a time. We thank you for our Sunday school teachers, for the children and youth and adults who attend. We thank you for the Advent devotional, and for those who put their hearts into it, that others might catch a glimpse of your presence and your spirit. We thank you for the gift of forgiveness. For without that promise, without the words that we speak, we would never even begin the journey of looking deep within ourselves, at the part of ourselves we would rather not see, and allow your spirit to begin to change us. And when you change us, when you change our hearts, when you change them in the face of anger and resentment, when you change our minds and our opinions go by the wayside and we listen better than we speak, when you change our bodies and we adjust to new ways of aging, whether it's slowing down or hearing less or just not being able to do certain things, you change us and give us new gifts of what we can do. We thank you that you are in charge of our lives, of our families, of our friends, of the strangers, of the aliens, and of the refugees who travel this world looking for a place to call home. Be with the homeless. Be with those who are hungry. Be with those who are in prisons. Be with those who are with hope, without hope. And be with each of us that we might look in the eyes of the hopeless, of the homeless, of those who are lost from their own spiritual dwellings and foundations. Those who have gone out to sea and long for the moorings of faith, let us be a part of inviting them back. For all these gifts, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, hallowed in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
We welcome all of you to our worship today and are grateful that you are part of some family as you visit friends and perhaps we're part of Thanksgiving celebrations. Flowers are given in loving memory of Judge and Mrs. Stevie Hunt and Mr. and Mrs. Harold Hunt by Paul and Wilma Hunt. The community dinner on Thursday will begin at 5:30. Debbie Wallace will be back on Wednesday, but gives us this message. French toast, casserole, sausage, and fresh fruit salad will be served. We do not need desserts or vegetables this week. If you can help, please come early or give Debbie a call after Wednesday. Friday night will be a fun night in the parlor. See Kirsten, but need more information, but kind of a free-for-all for fun. Kids' Day Inn. Okay, a week from Saturday in time to prepare for Christmas, so if you bring them in, they will be turned out. The Mission Committee will be having its first project that Saturday, and see Tom Heading if you would like to offer some more time or service in projects that will be upcoming. Also out in the assembly room will be Peace Be Still, the Advent devotional that Aaron has prepared. Please pick one up for yourself, or maybe pick up two and give one to a neighbor. This is a great invitation to get back to Christ at Christmas, and perhaps that devotional can be that Advent candle of light for them. Are there any other announcements this morning? Advent luncheon, a week from Sunday. And today we will be having the hanging of the greens. John Addy has already gotten out trees that you've seen around. And so if you can stay, the more hands the better, just pick a place. We've got to redecorate this one, we've got a wreath going up there, we've got trees in the assembly room, we've got down in the parlor and along the way, and wreaths for the doors. And if a group can plan a day to get together to do the outdoor nativity, that would be helpful too. So a place for everybody, stay as long as you can, work as long as you are able. If you're not able to work, just simply come and give directions, that's always helpful.
Giving thanks is for every day, not just Thanksgiving. Come, ye thankful people, come. Raise the song of harvest home.
Thank you.
around you, just as it does from us to you. May you be infused with strength and purity, filled with confidence in the presence of God our Father, when our Master Jesus arrives with all his followers.